So while we raise this day, let us begin our worship of God. Psalm calls us to worship today. Come and hear what God has done.
God has listened to all our prayers.
When we pass through the torrent of deep troubles, God turns the sea to dry land.
When we are tangled in the webnets of life, God does not let our feet slip.
When we are tested as silver is tried, God keeps us in the land of the living.
When we go through fire and water, God brings us to a safe place.
Come and hear what God has done. God surrounds us with steadfast love.
God gives and continues to give. None of us can outgive our God.
Let us worship God.
Thank you.
people who have cared for us, loved us, and helped us. Sometimes we are not appreciative of those who have gone before to give us faith and future. Sometimes we abuse our very own body for the resilient and patient support it offers. We confess that often we are thankful in our hearts, but at times are hesitant or negligent to express our thanks out loud. We confess that sometimes we lavish appreciation on others from a feeling of personal unworthiness and doubt of our own wholeness. As a people, we acknowledge our tendency to declare ourselves right and others wrong. In our world of distress and divide, bring us together in a way that only you can do. Heart healer, reach down deeply into our brokenness as individuals, as a society, and as a culture. Trouble our conscience enough to stir us, to reshape us toward honorable action. God, that you are, accept our repentance, we pray, and root us deeply in all things to sustain. Amen. And so, O God, it is in our silence that you hear even words that we do not say, but the silences of our hearts. In our silence, we cannot hide from you, nor can we hide from ourselves. Therefore, through Christ our Lord, we pray.
Amen.
God constantly calls us to live in God's kingdom, to be people of love, compassion, kindness, forgiveness, and support. These are things that are hard to do by ourselves, but when we give it over to God and let God show us the way, we will always find that our love deepens while our judgment fades. This is the power that Christ can have in us, for through Christ's forgiving love in our lives, we become more caring, grateful people.
Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
We thank you, choir, we thank you for the efforts you're putting out to bring beautiful, beautiful sounds and words to us. The gospel reading for this day, the scripture is just a portion in the context of the Sermon on the Mount. It was a time when Jesus was laying out some particular things about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God on earth. This passage today gives us some unique advice continuing with this theme of cultivating generosity. For the birds of the air, the bulletin reads, do not sow or reap or store away in barns. And then there's some particular advice that now comes to you, reading from the sixth chapter, a variety of excerpts, not straight through. The first piece of advice is take care. I'm reading from the Living Bible translation. Take care. Don't do your good deeds publicly to be admired, for then you will lose the reward. You will lose the inheritance from your Father in heaven. Last week, the scripture was about the inheritance that we received. It was about God's generosity. And through that generosity, we are claimed and named. We're called saints. We're given an inheritance. We're given special privileges. So this text is a counter to that. There's a way to lose that inheritance, apparently, according to this text. When you give a gift to a beggar, don't shout about it as the hypocrites do, blowing trumpets in the synagogues and streets to call attention to the activity, the acts of your charity. I tell you in all earnestness, the warnings continue, they have received all the reward that they will ever get. They will not receive their inheritance. They've received it now. But when you do a kindness to someone, do it secretly. Don't tell your left hand what your right hand is doing, and your Father, who knows all secrets, will reward you. Do it in that way, and we will be rewarded with their inheritance. Hang with me this morning. We're going to break this all apart and break it down later. How can you do something with your right hand and the left hand not knowing? Just a thought and a question to you. If you have the vision I do, most of us have good vision. We can see what one hand is doing. Don't store up treasures here on earth where they can erode away or may be stolen. Store them instead in heaven where they will never lose their value and will be safe from thieves. If your profits are in heaven, your heart will be there too. If your profits are in heaven, that is where your heart will be. So, my counsel is this. Don't worry about things. Don't worry about anything. Food, drink, clothes. For you already have life and the body, and they are far more important than what you eat or what you wear. Those of you that know me, I'm going to know that I have an argument with that. For you already have a life and a body, the scripture reads. Look at the birds. They don't worry about what to eat. They don't need to sow or reap or store up food. And I'm going to add it here, but squirrels do. They maybe some other creatures. And then do the squirrels remember where they store all those nuts, do they? I think they have short-term memory sometimes. For your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable to him than they are? Will all of your worries add a single moment to your life? And then concluding with the 34th verse. So, don't be anxious about tomorrow. God will take care of your tomorrow too. Live one day at a time. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you,
Lord. It's going to take a moment to pull that up, but I will. It was the year 1988. Somebody won a Grammy Award for a pop performance. It was a song sung a cappella. Bobby McFerrin was his name, and it actually became number one on the charts. And it is entitled, Don't Worry, Be Happy. It's scriptural.
Song I wrote, you might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry, be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile. But don't worry, be happy. 'Cause when you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, don't worry, don't do it. Be happy. Put a smile on your face. Don't bring everybody down like this. Don't worry. It will soon pass, whatever it is. Don't worry, be happy. I'm not worried.
By the way, I'm not trying to compete with the choir. So from 1988, when this was written, it quickly became popular by 1989. It was written in the context, it was in 1988, that the Dow Jones plummeted in one day over 500 points. So the man who was getting ready to jump out the window was a man depicted who had lost everything. And the comeback is, don't worry, be happy, everything's going to be all right. But is it? Was it? Well, he was also in a presidential campaign around that time. George H.W. Bush actually started using these words in his leadership. Until the artist asked him to not use those words. Bobby McFerrin. He was a jazz artist. He had mostly an adult audience. And yet he wrote his song at a time that artists were appealing to young and older, children, youth, and older people. Heavy metal was in at this time, Bon Jovi, Def Leppard. There were teen boppers at the time, Debbie Gibson being one. And then older groups were still popular here in the late 80s, like the Beach Boys, George Harrison, Chicago, and more. Bobby McFerrin wrote this unusual song to remind us of something the scriptures are still speaking to us today. At least the don't worry part. What does today's scripture add? The advice, the guidance, the perspective of Jesus in the context of really so many artists, so many songs through the years that have had a don't worry theme. An example was 1961, Marty Robbins had a hit by the title simply Don't Worry, all the way back to 1961. Stevie Wonder sang a song in 1974, one he wrote himself. It was entitled Don't Worry About a Thing. Stevie Wonder. And Bob Marley in 1977 wrote a song entitled Three Little Birds. Kind of reminds me of the scripture today. God takes care of the little birds. They do not worry. They are fed and taken care of by God. Those songs basically had a message, don't worry about a thing because every little thing is going to be all right. And even jumping from the 60s to the 70s into the 80s and into the 90s, the 1994 movie of The Lion King included these words, Hakuna Matata, meaning no worries, don't worry. It was the key song. It was a major point in the plot of The Lion King. One thing I would like to say about this is that whether we realize it or not, we in the church, we in the faith community, that often there are biblical and spiritual and scriptural themes woven into the popular culture. Some of these artists themselves have become converts. Some are very secular, we might say, don't care about faith in the church, but yet they speak the voice of prophets and even of Jesus. Don't worry, be happy. And that phrase, don't worry, be happy, came from even somewhere else. It came from an Indian guru named Maher Baba. So see, everybody borrows and bombs off of everybody else. We borrow these words and we appropriate them ourselves. So let's walk back through the scripture to hear it afresh. The first discussion in today's reading was point blank about the way we reach out compassionately to others. The giving of alms, the helping of the poor, and the specific reference to giving to beggars. Well, you know, in Jesus' day, there were no governmental safety nets. There was no Social Security, no disability payments, no Medicaid. Begging was a part of the culture. It was the way people received help if they needed it. It's the reason people of faith in the Jewish community gave alms at the synagogue. It was alms for the poor. That was the safety net of the day. And Jesus was not concerned about those who were giving. It was the way they were giving. Jesus was warning his listeners of the pitfalls of expected religious behavior. Because any of us and all of us, even in modern day times, can get caught in pride about what we're doing and for whom we're doing and even maybe why we're doing it. And that can lead to self-justification based on what we're doing rather than trusting what God is doing through what we can do. That's what Jesus is warning. It was expected in Jesus' day for the believers, the Jewish community, to be pious. They were to fast, they were to pray, and they were to give alms. Those were the three main things. And on top of it, yes, they were supposed to show up to the synagogue or the local temple to worship and to hear the rabbi preach, teach. They were supposed to do that as well. So faithful people, we, faithful people, are to do right things, good things. But we are to do them in right ways. So what Jesus is addressing is not only how we do what we do in the life of the church and our motivations for doing it. So why do we do what we do in the life of the church? It's not to give our church, Leacock, a good name, really, or to elevate us in the community. It's to serve the needs of people, to witness to the love and care of God. Take care, the scripture reads, do not let your good deeds be used publicly for admiration, for then you will lose your reward from your Father in heaven. When you give a gift to a beggar, don't shout about it as the hypocrites do. Now, hypocrites in the New Testament is a Greek word, and it has a particular meaning. It doesn't mean being insincere. It doesn't mean being deceptive. The word hypocrite in Greek was the phrase for staged actors. Actors who wore masks and covered their faces so their identity couldn't be seen. But the identity of the character they were portraying was out in front of the people. Jesus was implying here false godliness. Do not present one picture to the wider world when inwardly there's another picture. Jesus' mention of religious people as hypocrites goes well beyond saying, hey, you're not showing your charity or generosity in the right way. Jesus' criticism is far deeper. What you are doing demonstrates that you are not really the person you want us and God to believe that you are. The scripture mentions blowing trumpets in the synagogues, in the streets. Now, by the way, the people who first heard this would be starting to laugh at that point, because that's just ridiculous. Nobody blew trumpets in the synagogues or out on the street. The idea of sounding a trumpet when giving money is really a joke. No one would do such a thing. Yet the overkill of that expression acknowledges that sometimes people give, sometimes we give, to make a public declaration of our own authority or importance. I did it, I'm guilty of it. Friday evening, I officiated a wedding at former Camp Bumble, Mill Creek Falls retreat. And the bartender, there was lemonade, tea, and water, okay? Oh yes, there was some other stuff too. The bartender was a young person that I had counseled during his senior year of high school. I volunteered for years in the local school, helping with mock senior interviews to help the graduates prepare for their jobs. He was one of them. And he was a bartender, and he said, this is the first time I've ever bartended. So I said, you know, just let people tell you what they want, and they will tell you. I want, you know, ginger ale with rum in it or whatever. And then there was a donation container, a nice big jar right there for him. The last time I walked up for lemonade and cranberry, yes, I did have something in it, I made a point of his saying that I put something in his jar. Because I wanted him to know I wasn't taking advantage of having known him. I wasn't taking advantage of my status as a pastor. Like, I just, you know, pastors let everybody else take care of them, right? We don't lift a finger, really, do we? No. And I made sure, and I pointed, because I wanted him to know I was contributing to his well-being, and to his partner in life, and to a two-year-old child that they have together. Blowing trumpets, the idea of sounding a trumpet when giving money. That kind of motivation, however, was absolutely acceptable in the Roman patronage system. So the wider cultural context with the Roman authorities and the Roman government and the paying of taxes and all that, in the patronage system, when the recipients of a gift were required to show loyalty back to the givers. It was the way it was. It was about earning a reward. But Jesus switches it up. I tell you in all earnestness, those who do these things, give in this way, have received all of the reward they will ever get. That is because if we give in that way, we think we're earning the attention and the recognition. It was Jesus' way of pounding the pulpit and saying, with God, you can't earn a reward. It's given to you. Your inheritance, what you earn, is given because you're loved. You're beloved. You're a child of God. You're a saint. You are given it. You do not earn it. No amount of giving, no amount of public show will ever give you the reward that God only can give. And by the way, we do sort of have to wait for it according to this word of scripture. It is consummated in the kingdom of heaven. And by the way, many of Matthew's parables do just this. They talk about, well, there's the realities now, but there's the reality later, the kingdom of heaven. And Matthew also talks about judgment and accountability before God. Because when it comes to that time, apparently, again, according to Matthew, there are privileges given in the kingdom of heaven, and there are corrections and punishments as well. But, and it's a big B-U-T, but when you do a kindness to someone, do it secretly. Don't tell your left hand what your right hand is doing. For your Father in heaven, who knows and sees all secrets, will reward you. By the way, this is hyperbole and exaggeration to make a point. I mean, we know what our both hands are doing. Generosity toward God, what is it? Think about the other images in the New Testament, the widow's mite. It's not about quantity. It's not about the amount. When compared to the wealthy givers who showed up at the temple, depicted by the Pharisees in the Gospel according to Matthew, who were making a show of what they were giving. And the widow's mite, the widow who comes along and just drops in the last coin that she had, the scripture points out. The emphasis is that there's a righteousness which is apart from quantity. That the qualities and practices are not simply earthly doings, but rather the smallest, even the smallest of charitable, compassionate, loving acts has implications, not only now, but for the beyond in the kingdom of heaven. And so the emphasis is then on what it motivates us and what sustains us in the actions that we do personally, individually, and as a church. I want you to think about that with me for a moment. What motivates us, you, we, together here at Leacock? What motivates us? What sustains us? By your presence this morning, you're telling me that you who are here are sustained by coming here, by making the effort to get up on Sunday morning and the other days in which we gather. You come to be sustained and nurtured by togetherness, the sense of community, by the words that you hear, the music that you hear. You come to be inspired, lifted up. You come here to be motivated and sustained and to be the people of God together. The gospel goes on to say that while we are down here, we are not to store up treasures on this earth, for they can erode, and they do, its chemistry, its biology, everything erodes, everything declines, everything degrades in its own time. And Jesus knew that. Jesus must have been a pretty good biologist and a chemist, is the way I figure. Store up instead, Jesus said, store your treasures in heaven, where they will never lose value, or erode, or decay. By the way, this past week I saw on Maryland Public Television a whole special on non-traditional burials, on composting the human body. It's being done, it's now legal in the state of Colorado, and it probably will be a growing practice, where the body is taken into a large encasement and layered as we would in our compost piles in our backyards. Maybe a layer of grass and trimmings, and then leaves and twigs, and then another layer. And bodies, human bodies that are done in this way, actually, our main body can decline in about 2 or 3 months. What's left is the calcium, our bones and our teeth. That takes longer. but composting the body away for the future. By the way, it takes about 30 gallons of fuel to cremate a body. And so is that environmentally a way forward? Well, it's less expensive than traditional burial. If anybody from Chavres is here today, my apologies. But by the way, Chavres and others are on to it because I went to the open house over in Willow Street, the new funeral home that's there, and they had their own crematorium. Right in, I saw it, I saw the chamber, right in the funeral home. So funeral homes are adapting. I just don't know if they're up to composting yet. But that's an aside. You know, my trash brain does at times just flow out. Well, Jesus is doing this contrasting the treasure between earth and treasures in heaven. And Jesus notes that our possessions and the acquisition of things always has the potential to corrupt us, to make us vulnerable to greed and misplaced priorities. So gathering treasures for heaven refers to conducting ourselves in a way down here, where we anticipate both God's judgment and God's reward. Both, it's both, they go together. There will be a time, Jesus declares, of balancing things out. There will be a time of correction. Even in the gospel, the first shall be last and the last first, that says something about it. So this becomes a question for us. What lasts? What endures? What stands the test of time? Or I'm going to change it up. What stands the test of the beyond? I made that up myself. See, now I'm like, I'm disobeying Jesus and I'm patting myself on the shoulder. I'm prideful. Just tell me to put the duct tape on. What stands the test of the beyond? Well, these words have an answer for us. So my counsel is, don't worry about things, food, drink, and clothes. The first priority of generosity, stated in the words I've read to you today, is generosity toward ourselves. Take my counsel, Jesus said. This is for we, us, ourselves, our own well-being. Don't worry about things. Look at the birds. To celebrate God's generosity, we begin first by celebrating generosity to ourselves. And I think this is a unique teaching of Jesus, by the way. God's generosity is toward us when we show it toward ourselves. Don't be anxious about tomorrow. God will take care of your tomorrow. Live one day at a time. The gospel reading ends today. Our generosity is based on God's generosity. It's based on our taking care of ourselves by not worrying. And maybe sometimes we're happy and maybe sometimes we're not happy. But at least be with me and get the don't worry part. Free ourselves from anxiety. And then the second part of this generosity is toward God, toward the poor, toward the disadvantaged. Jesus is not discouraging the giving of help to those who have need. We are to practice generosity to ourselves by not worrying. We are to practice generosity toward others by not making it a prideful show or an act or by justifying ourselves. Because in the end, God justifies us. God accepts us. God honors us. This means, however much we have can be of use to God and others. How much you have, how much I have, can be of use to God and others, because it promotes a vision of righteousness, helping us to receive a taste of what God desires for ourselves and for the world. Let me hear an amen.
Amen.
Our hymn of response. Don't worry, be happy. Oh no, it's in my life. And now you're going to be singing that tune. I'm sure some of you all have missed the day. Shown us out of which we are able to give, to take care of our own needs, and also to serve the needs of others. We pray that you will help us to have good balance in our lives as best as we are able to make it, knowing that at times that is not true. Guard our motivations, lead us toward purity in thought and deed. Through Christ we pray. Amen.
You have made known your love and power in unexpected ways and places.
We pray that you will continue to divide in so many places in the world that particularly need a godly and holy presence, where there is only the presence of darkness and evil and harm and defeat. May we daily perceive the joy and wonder of your abiding presence as we continue to offer our lives in gratitude for the redemption we have received. And now together, the people of God, may we pray together the prayer you've left all faithful disciples through the generations to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from